Assalamu alaikum, hello, and welcome to the Health Show Live here only on the Islam Channel with me, Alistair Greener. The Health Show aims to cover all matters concerning your health and to keep you informed and healthy by discussing a wide range of topics. Now, we do encourage you at home to call in and talk to us about these very issues because we'd really like to get your questions answered. We must stress, though, that should you suffer from any medical problems, it's always highly recommended that you contact your doctor or GP, as the Health Show gives you an alternative viewpoint to the health concern being discussed. If you'd like to speak to our expert today, the number to call will be 020 7374 6423. But don't call just yet, as the lines will be open later in the show. You can also email us at healthshow@islamchannel.tv. Now, today we're welcoming Nuzhat Ali, a National Health Wellbeing Lead and Musculoskeletal Lead for Public Health England. She specialises in ageing, dementia risk reduction and musculoskeletal health. Her work involves supporting national and local government, the NHS, voluntary and community sector organisations and businesses to help provide support and aid the elderly to live a healthy and productive lifestyle. Thank you very much indeed for joining us.
Thank you very much for having me.
You sound like a very busy person. Now, we're going to be talking to you a little bit more in a while, but before we do that, let's take a look and see how poetry provides a gateway to the past for Alzheimer's sufferers.
Oh, let us be married, too long we have tarried, but what shall we do for a...
Miriam and Margaret have Alzheimer's and struggle to remember what happened last week, let alone 10 minutes ago.
Dance by the light of the moon.
But when they hear a few lines from a poem learnt decades ago at school, the memories come flooding back.
We did talk a certain amount of poetry at home, always. I think my aunts knew that when I was small, and my mother, you know, they all knew it, and so I can't remember life without it.
For 4 years, the organisation Kissing It Better has used poetry as a means of fighting memory loss. Young people from local schools here in Stratford-upon-Avon in central England visit the elderly in nursing homes, giving poetry recitals and singing songs.
You can keep your head when...
Oh, yes.
When they're feeling sad or lonely, or they can't connect very easily, if somebody says a poem that they knew so well 60, 70 years ago, they suddenly smile because they found something that they remember. And when they have that memory, along with it comes the school days, the wartime, the family, the countryside. So it's that important anchor in what is a very bewildering world if you have dementia.
And these recitals don't just benefit those on the receiving end.
I feel like I can give something to the community, and they've given stuff to us, and I want to give it back to them. And I hope in a few years' time, when I'm old, people will come visit me and read to me and sing to me. So.
Shall I compare thee to a summer's day?
Stratford-upon-Avon is the birthplace of Shakespeare, and even former actors from the Royal Shakespeare Company take part, reciting sonnets by the bard.
You get something back from them, you see that glimmer in their eye, and it's wonderful when suddenly they join in with a line.
Experts say the use of poetry cannot cure Alzheimer's, but there's no doubt it brings sufferers comfort and with it confidence from a bygone era.
A Wow, what a great video. And today we are talking about dementia. Nuzhat, it's really interesting watching that particular programme because that's actually what we associate with dementia. Older people, you know, who are struggling with their memory but sometimes remember the older things. Let's get back to real basics because we were talking there about Alzheimer's and we hear lots of different terms. Dementia, Alzheimer's and, you know, all sorts of other terms as well, some not as complimentary as others. Give me a description of exactly what dementia is.
So dementia is a sort of umbrella term under which there are a number of different types of dementia. So Alzheimer's, as you've just seen in the video, is one of the types, which is the most common type. And so therefore, a lot of people sort of interchange the words, but dementia is the umbrella terminology. There is Alzheimer's, which is one of the types. There's something called vascular dementia. There is frontal temporal lobe, which is another part of the brain and one of the types of dementia. You have Lewy body dementia. And so those are some of the key or the larger types of dementia. But there are actually approximately 100 plus types of different dementia, depending on where where they affect the brain.
And we normally associate dementia with short-term memory loss. Would that be a fair way to describe it?
Not really a fair way of describing it because dementia is a set of various symptoms, of which one of them is short memory loss. But there are a whole range of different types of symptoms. And again, it depends very much on the type of dementia. So it may be, it might affect the brain's part of the brain where your mood is affected, for example. It may have an impact on people's language, their orientation. So again, depending on the type of dementia, the symptoms that people will see will be different. But usually people say, oh, I've started to forget things, which is one of the signs or symptoms of early onset.
Okay, well, let's look at this, the mechanics of it, because we understand it's to do with brain function, if you like. So how big a problem is this in Britain today?
In Britain, we have just under 1 million people that in the UK that are diagnosed and we know have dementia. So it's about 850,000 currently in England. And it is a condition which generally affects people as we age. So large number of people, as you saw in the video, generally over the age of 85 upwards. However, there are types of dementia that will impact and affect people in younger age groups as well.
And we actually have a slide, I think our next slide gives us an idea of the size of the issue here in Britain. If we can just go to the next slide a second, because then we get a bit of an idea that as we become an ageing population, which we absolutely are, what a big issue it is and how much it costs.
Absolutely. So this is sort of current data in terms of the cost of dementia to the UK society. And it's not just the cost to the economy, i.e. to the government, or third sector voluntary providers. But also, if you can see, 11.6 billion is on unpaid care. That's us, family, people that have to give up their work and then care for somebody. And that is, there's an estimation of about 11.76 billion on that, with 5.8 billion on social care. 4.3 billion on healthcare. So the actual cost is very, very significant. It's very high.
And the chances are it's going to get even more as we get older. So let's just go to the next slide because we've got a lot of really interesting information here. And you were talking there about the amount of people who have it, but actually looking forward with our aging population that we're talking about, 2 million.
That's right. The UK population is aging very rapidly. And what that basically means is that we're living longer. And because we're living longer and our demographics are changing very rapidly, so people are living longer. And by 2025, we estimate that over 1 million people could have dementia in the UK. And by 2050, we could exceed 2 million people with dementia in the UK. So if you look at the actual cost to the system and the numbers,
it's quite staggering,
it
isn't
is.
It? Okay, let's move on and look at the risks of dementia. Who is mostly at risk?
So as I mentioned earlier, as we age, specifically after the age of 85, that's when the actual sort of a diagnosis, but the numbers actually increase significantly, and hence one of the reasons why you see more women with dementia, as in the video, than men. But if we just look at this slide now, so the aging population at age 65. Currently, there are 11.4 million people in the UK at that age group, of which we estimate there are about 1 in 14 of that population currently have dementia. But as the population ages and gets to 85, that number then increases quite significantly.
Okay. So, again, moving on, let's take a look at, you were talking there about women, and that statistic actually is probably not very helpful, because actually it's not taking into account, as you say, life expectancy for women is higher.
So, as you can see here, we know that 62% of people with dementia are female, 38% are male. So women out there, please don't get very worried that you think you're at the highest, higher and highest risk. You're not, because, as I said, that we know that the life expectancy in women is higher in the UK, and therefore that is reflected. There is some evidence currently that potentially indicates that women past the menopause may be at a higher risk. But again, that is something that is still being researched in terms of how that affects your risk.
Okay. And again, now looking at different risk factors, and because there was this view for quite some time, wasn't there, that it was just it would either happen or it wouldn't. It was just one of those things. You couldn't really contribute to your chance of developing it through your lifestyle, but that wouldn't look like it.
Absolutely. So over the last probably 5 to 10 years, the evidence and the strength of the evidence from research globally has indicated that there is something that people can do earlier on in life to reduce their risk of dementia. And we say reduce risk because we also know that genetics plays a part in whether people will or will not get.
So there's a higher chance if you do have a relative or a close relative who's developed dementia, then there's a higher chance of you developing
it. Yes, absolutely. But the positive thing is that we can reduce our risk by looking at various parts, lifestyle, modifiable risk factors.
And actually, a lot of these are things that we actually associate with normal good health. So actually, you're helping your health not just with dementia, but actually across the board.
Absolutely.
And I know that our next slide is about, I think it's about smoking, which again, seems to be something that's so much of an issue that people
Absolutely.
Talk about.
One thing we know, and the evidence is very, very clear, is that if you've got diabetes, or you're at risk of diabetes, or coronary vascular disease, or you've had a stroke, you're at a much higher risk of getting dementia, one of the types of dementia. So therefore, the risk factors that, you know, people are aware that diet's really important, living a active lifestyle is really important to prevent your risk of diabetes. We know that those same risk factors can have a huge impact on reducing your risk of dementia. But also, if someone's been diagnosed with dementia, it can actually mitigate and reduce the pace at which that dementia progresses. So it's really important that if someone, people say, oh, right, okay, we've been diagnosed with dementia, there's very little we can do. That's not the case.
So actually, as a preventative tool, but also as a way to mitigate,
absolutely, to slow down the progression of the condition. So this slide, I mean, it just gives some sort of thoughts around what you can do. So, A, there are the factors around diet, smoking, physical activity, which are key and important. And then this talks a little bit, this slide is about things that you can do around social engagement. actually having friends and family around, having those social networks and links is really important. We know, again, from the evidence base where there have been studies where they've looked at children at young age and then whether they have or they haven't developed dementia, that education in early years, very significant factor.
We hear a lot about, as well, about exercising the brain, doing puzzles, crosswords and things. Is that one of those folklore things or is that actually validity in that?
There is some evidence that actually using the brain to problem solve, there is very strong evidence around learning a second language that actually could A, protect, but B, also the progression, rate of progression can be reduced. So learn a second language.
So we've talked a lot about, you know, developing it and also prevention and so on. Now let's look at very, very quickly, just before we go to break, about people who maybe have someone in their family who's just developed it. What can they be doing? We've talked about, obviously, nutritionally, but what about you? We're talking there very briefly about engagement and interactivity with people at different stages of dementia. Give us a bit more of an idea of that.
Yeah, I mean, if someone has a diagnosis of dementia, it's not a death sentence. That's first and foremost really important to raise. And you may find that that particular person, it may take 10, 15 years for it to progress, or it may be a couple of years. So there's no hard and fast rule. Each individual, depending on the type of dementia, will be very, very different. But what family friends can do is ensure that the social connections are maintained, as you saw in that video, you know, things that that particular person enjoyed whilst they were younger.
We'll talk a little bit more about that and a lot more. I feel like we've only just had the tip of the iceberg, but it is now time for a short break. But when we return, we'll be talking more about dementia, but also taking your calls as well. So don't go anywhere. We'll be right back. Welcome back to The Health Show, where our topic today is dementia. The phone lines are now open and the number to call is 020-7374-6423. Again, that number is 020-7374-6423. And of course, if you prefer, you can also email us at healthshow@islamchannel.tv. And once again, we must stress that should you suffer from any medical problems, it's always highly recommended that you contact your doctor or GP, as The Health Show gives you an alternative viewpoint to the health concern being discussed. And again, talking about dementia, what I want to talk about while we wait for calls to come in is the help and support that's available for people around those loved ones who may have just developed it or maybe at advanced stages of dementia.
I think first and foremost, if people haven't had a diagnosis, the diagnosis is really important because once the person's been diagnosed by the GP or memory clinic, the support systems start to kick in. Because if the diagnosis is not there, then it's very difficult to get the support in terms of the support from the NHS and then support also from social care if needed, if the condition progresses. So support systems are available. So there are third sector organisations such as Alzheimer's Research UK and Alzheimer's Society, who are voluntary charity organisations who have a whole plethora of support that's available in terms of information, helplines, they have friending services, they've got a whole...
And I presume the first point of contact for most people will be their GP, who will obviously point them in the right direction. And you talked there about memory clinics. Is this something you would get referred to if you had concerns?
Yeah. So the GP would refer to the memory clinic and the memory clinic would do a fuller assessment. And through that fuller assessment, they would be able to then confirm the diagnosis. And once that diagnosis has been confirmed, the GP, you should be able to go back to your GP or the memory. Different parts of the country work quite differently, but those two NHS organisations will be able to provide indication of the support mechanisms and the support that's available to the individual and to the carer, because the carer needs to be supported. It's really
now, obviously,
important.
You were talking earlier on about timing being crucial, and the earlier you can get a diagnosis, the better. Yes. What are the sort of common signs that people might notice within themselves or a relative seeing it in someone else?
Mood, Mood and behaviour change is one of the things that people often say, that they're behaving very differently. Forgetting things. So you've put your keys somewhere and they might be right in front of you, but you've forgotten. Forgetfulness is one of them. Mood is another one. Some people will complain of hallucinations or seeing things, hearing things. So it does vary according to the individual and, of course, the type of dementia. But those are some of the early signs that you should start thinking, OK, I need to go to the GP.
And again, I know we're going to have lots of callers who are going to have a lot of questions about dementia, whether it's personal or whether it's someone within your family. And we do actually have our very first caller this afternoon. So a very good afternoon. Perhaps you could tell us who you are and where you're calling from this afternoon.
Hiya, my name's Hannah. I'm calling from London. Thank you for this very important topic you're covering on your show. I was just wondering if you could elaborate a little bit on the differences between Alzheimer's and dementia.
Yeah, it's a common question, isn't it?
Yes.
Which is one of the reasons I started with it.
That's right.
We do get confused, don't we?
Yeah, so basically dementia, if you think of dementia as an overarching term, it's the umbrella term. And under that term, dementia, are different types of dementia, of which Alzheimer's is one, and it's the largest type of dementia. And Alzheimer's is very common. I think it's about a third of, it may even be up to 35 to 40% of dementia are Alzheimer's. So the types of symptoms that you'll see in people with Alzheimer's will be different from maybe another type of dementia.
And which form of dementia is the one that tends to be genetic, or can it cross the board?
There is a type of dementia which currently there is more research going, but it's one single gene that runs in families, and that one single gene is responsible for that type of dementia. And it generally, that type of dementia affects people under the age of 65. But any type of dementia, there is a genetic component, and it's not one gene, it's a number of genes that are responsible for.
We have just had an email question that came in, and the author of the email wants to stay anonymous, which is absolutely fine, but thank you very much indeed for your question. And the question was about the dangers of dementia. We're obviously aware of the progression and, you know, the severity of it, but is it something you actually die from, or do you develop complications as a result of dementia?
Both. Both. People, especially in the UK, I'm not aware of how the death certificate works in other countries, but dementia, or specifically the type of dementia, will be recorded as cause of death on the death certificate. Complications can occur. There are a whole range of complications. There's one type of dementia which is called Lewy body dementia, and one of the complications is high risk of falling. And Parkinson's, it's very closely linked to Parkinson's. So in response to the question, it's both. People do die of dementia, but then also complications arise as a result of dementia as well.
Now, we actually broadcast throughout the world in Asia and Africa, and one of the questions we often get associated with different health concerns is that of ethnicity.
Yes.
And are certain ethnicities more prone to dementia than others, or is it fairly balanced?
Conditions. I won't say parts of the world, but basically there are certain conditions that put you at a higher risk of dementia. And those conditions are diabetes, and we know that diabetes is more prevalent in Southeast Asian, Black Caribbean, African communities, for example. We know that cardiovascular disease and those populations that are at higher risk of cardiovascular disease are also at a higher risk, because the most types of dementia have what we call a vascular dimension to them. And basically what that means in layman's terms is that the arteries, the blood flow is restricted, and therefore it affects the brain significantly.
So it's really more lifestyle than your ethnicity per se?
Yeah. But we know that diabetes, there's a high predisposition within, there's a 4 to 8, depending on the research and parts of the world, with diabetes, for example, there's a 4 to 8 times higher predisposition in Southeast Asian communities. And I know that in parts of the Middle East, for example, diabetes is running at a very high prevalence rate. So they are young populations currently, given that we know that dementia is a condition of older age, we've got a time bomb ticking. So people need to really, really sort of focus on the lifestyle factors that
can reduce
risk.
And we hear more and more lifestyle factors in all areas of our health.
Absolutely.
And it is quite interesting. And please do give us a call if you've got any questions about dementia. We would love to hear from you, because the chances are there's somebody else wanting to know that exact same answer. And we do have another call, so a very good afternoon. Perhaps you could tell us who you are and where you're calling from today.
Hi there. Good afternoon. I'm calling from London. And great show, by the way.
Thank you.
My question is, I actually have a close family friend who went through dementia, and, well, her husband actually went through dementia, and he passed away very recently, actually. And as a family friend, I'm sort of struggling to sort of, you know, give her support and advice, really, because what it is, it's she's sort of going through trauma and stress at the moment. So my question is really, is just to find out what kind of advice or how would you suggest for someone as a family friend, what kind of advice would you give to someone who's going through that trauma, you know, so the aftermath, really, of that whole situation. So it's very difficult at this moment to kind of be able to speak to her and to listen to her thoughts, because she's really under a lot of stress. So that's my question, really. I don't know how else to phrase it better.
No, that's fine. Thank you very much indeed for your question. And in fact, that's a question so typical of many questions I know that people have. And I know from personal experience, my great aunt had dementia. And it's obviously a very upsetting thing to watch someone you care for and love, to see them suffering and going through dementia. But for the people watching, it's very difficult to know exactly what to do and how to respond. Do you have any sort of golden rules in terms of how best to deal with it?
As a carer and family member and friend, I think what's very important is that you've got to remember that person in front of you. They may be forgetting things, they may have all those symptoms as a result of their condition, but they are still that loved person. And so bearing that in mind and trying to ensure that whatever you do, whether it's food that they used to enjoy, we know that food, reminiscing on stories, on memories, whether it's music or whatever it is that that particular individual used to do in their times of where they did remember, trying to ensure that we can support them through that process. And I think what's also very important to actually share the load of caring across family and friends and neighbours, and having that network, that social network, and talking about those things with family. But just touching on the caller's question, I think any type of bereavement, whether it's from dementia, whether it's from cancer, is always very, very difficult. And as Muslims, we believe that, you know, life and death is in God's hands, and that a time has been set for that. And I think consoling your relative or family friend, as you said, is really important, and reminding her of the good times, and that we all belong to Allah, and to Him we will return. So it's consolation, and being there, I think, is really important when someone's been bereaved, regardless of the condition.
And it is interesting that, you know, you use the term bereavement, because it is, you are losing the person. Although you might not have physically lost them, you do feel emotionally that, you know, you have lost them. Yeah. One of the things that I remember the carer of my great aunt said, which again, I'm sure many people have experienced, is that people don't know how to treat them. So people in their community who all of a sudden someone has dementia And she said people started staying away because they didn't know how to confront and deal with it. Now, that was some years ago, so hopefully we've got better. But I really liked what she said about sharing the burden.
Yeah, absolutely. I think within certain communities, and as you mentioned, the program is global, so there are still parts of the world where that probably still happens, Alistair. I think it's really important, A, we talk about it, and we share what we know about it with our communities, and we actually realise that this is a condition that a condition of the brain, and it's striking more and more people as we've seen the figures in the UK. So we talk about it, we share the knowledge that we have, and we look at how we can support families and friends and neighbours through various means, whether that's helping with cooking a meal, or whether it's going round, popping round, whether it might be to just sort of, maybe for a couple of hours, just go in while the carer or whoever's taking care just is able to go out and do small chores, you know.
Just being there, as you say, having a cup of tea, listening to stories and things is a great help. And we actually have just one final call this afternoon. So thank you again for calling in. Who are you and where are you calling from, please?
Hi, my name's Sadie. I'm calling from London. My question is, my grandmother has dementia and she has very often moments where she's present, but it's very short periods and it's different times. So I wanted to know, when the person that has dementia is lucid, is there things that can kind of bring it more often? Is there a reason why they're lucid at certain times? I just want clarity on that part.
That's a great question in itself. And again, it's something that people don't quite know how to deal with. You get these moments, as our caller said, where they're present or lucid, and then all of a sudden it goes back in. Is there anything that we can do during those lucid moments to keep them going longer, or maybe to even sort of bring about that moment sooner?
Again, I think it depends on the type of dementia that the individual has. And that's quite a common feature with dementia. You know, for moments they might be fine, and then the next minute they might be hallucinating, or they're becoming very forgetful, or they don't know where they are. So it's quite a common symptom. In terms of advice around managing with that, I think it's recognizing that that is part of the condition. That's really important. There are treatments in terms of cognitive behavioural therapy, depending again on the type of condition. Certain medications and drugs can assist, can help. Some people will say that certain types of diet will help as well. But I think it's very much up to the carers to test, to try, but speak to your general practitioner or doctor if people want more information and more advice.
And just in the last couple of minutes, one of the things that seems quite encouraging, we were talking before the show about how the UK is actually at the forefront of much of the research that's taking place at the moment. And we hear lots of news all the time about dementia. Where are we in terms of our learning and progression and understanding of the disease?
I think in terms of understanding what causes the disease and what the risk factors are, we know that there potentially are several risk factors that contribute to the condition. And, you know, I think every few months that goes by, there is something that we hear that potentially it could be a contributory factor. So we know sleep, for example, that poor quality sleep, and the evidence indicates that over long periods in one's life, if people are not sleeping properly, that potentially could increase your risk of getting dementia. There was, I think last year, there was some evidence that indicated that people that live on main busy roads, very close to main busy roads, where there are high levels of pollutants, potentially that could be putting people at a higher risk of dementia.
I mean, there is a huge amount, and again, as I said in the end of the first half, I feel like we've just
touched the surface,
to the very tip of the iceberg of it, but it's a fascinating subject. affect, and so much more that we can learn from it. And it would be very interesting to see the developments over the next few years. But sadly, we're out of time now. But thank you very much. And as I say, that is all time we've got, all the time we have today. So I'd like to thank our guest, Nuzhat Ali, for coming into the studio and for sharing so much of her valuable information with us. Thank you so much.
Welcome.
And thank you for watching at home, and especially to those of you who call today into the show. If you'd like any more information about the topics we've discussed today's show, or for that matter on any of the shows in this series, then please do email us at healthshow@islamchannel.tv. Join me next time for another Health Show Live. Goodbye for now. Assalamu alaikum.